today at the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies. I'm Lizbeth Gant-Britton, and it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dolen Perkins-Valdez. Dolen Perkins-Valdez received a BA in Afro-American and East Asian Studies from Harvard University and an MFA in Creative Writing from the University of Memphis. Last year, she received a PhD in English from George Washington University, where she was a George McCandless Fellow in American Literature. She has presented papers at numerous national conferences, including the American Literature Association, the National Association of African American Studies, and the College Language Association. Dolen is currently a University of California President's Postdoctoral Fellow, and she is in residence here at the Ralph J. Bunche Center for the 2003-2004 academic year. And we're so happy to have her. And she and her faculty mentor, Richard Yarborough, wishes her very well today. He couldn't be here because he's in New York reading, he's in Washington, D.C. reading Ford Foundation Fellowships. Dolen's research focuses on racial violence in the progressive era. She's analyzing the discourse surrounding anti-black riot violence and its impact upon racial ideologies. The title of her talk today is Mob Stories, Race, Nation, and Racial Violence in the Progressive Era. I give you Dr. Perkins-Valdez.
First, thank you to Professor Gant-Britton for introducing me and being so gracious and generous to be here today. And I also want to take this opportunity to thank the Ralph Bunche Center for hosting me this year. It has been an invaluable part of my newly founded career to have this time to read and think. And staff at the Ralph Bunche Center has been great in terms of making this year as worry-free as possible, so I want to thank them. I also want to thank Richard Yarborough in absentia, who, as mentioned before, couldn't be here today, but he has been an invaluable resource for me and has really helped me to think through these ideas and has literally struggled through the process with me, so I want to take this opportunity to publicly acknowledge him. And I also want to thank all of you for coming out today, and of course, as you might know, it's a scholar's worst fear that you have this topic that you're obsessed about for so long and no one cares about it. So it's really nice to have some friendly faces here today, and I just want to let you know that I really appreciate it, and I look forward to hearing your questions and comments later. As you can see from the screen, we're specifically talking about one of the anti-black riots during the progressive era, Atlanta in 1906. And when I first gave the title of my talk, I had only been in Los Angeles for a couple of weeks, so I really didn't know exactly where my research would lean most heavily. And it has taken me back to Atlanta, which continues to sort of draw my interest. It's one of the most vicious riots of this period, and there's just been very little work done on it, so I wanted to talk about that today. I'm going to begin by outlining the structure of my talk, just to let you know where I'm going with all of this. I'm going to start by giving a brief synopsis of my project and let you know how the Atlanta riots contextualized in all of the other riots I'm working on. And I also will then go through a slideshow and we'll talk about the riot itself, because inevitably I always get questions about what was happening in Atlanta at the time. So we're going to contextualize my comments in the actual event. And on the second half of the slideshow, we'll talk about who the major players were in the post-riot discourse, because as mentioned before, I'm specifically focusing on, I come from an English department, I'm not a historian, so I have to make that disclaimer right now. And so I'm specifically focusing on responses, particularly written, published responses to the racial violence. So we'll talk about who the major players were in the post-riot discourse. And then I have a poem, which is, if you don't have one, we'll put it up in a bit. There's one on the table and it's been passed around. A Litany of Atlanta by Du Bois, which we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I want that to be interactive and hear some of your comments on it. So, I'll begin by just talking a little bit about the project itself. This began as my dissertation, and the dissertation actually spanned from the antebellum riots in Philadelphia in the 1840s all the way up to Chicago 1919. I originally was interested in this because I was really sort of wondering how did contemporary violent protest riots, such as that that happened in Los Angeles in 92, what was the precursor to that type of riot, and at what point, what were the factors that contributed to the transition from these kinds of anti-black massacres to violent protest, riot as violent protest. And as most of you probably know, these riots that I'm talking about are not protest riots. These are riot, or someone might say they're white protests, but these are actually attacks on African-American communities, African-American businesses, residential districts, and people. So that was how I sort of came to it. One of the most beneficial parts of my post office that I have narrowed down my time span, because it was really difficult to make connections between antebellum Philadelphia and, you know, Red Summer of 1919, and so I've narrowed it down to the Progressive Era, which has also fascinated me because, of course, as you know, it was a time of incredibly enforced Jim Crow legislation and segregation, and it was also the height of lynching, particularly in the 1890s. So that's the scope of my project, and I'm going to start by giving sort of a brief overview of the riot itself. Some of the historical aspects of the riot, I have to acknowledge other scholars who have done that work and given me that foundation. People such as Mark Bauerlein, Charles Crow, Gregory Mixon, who actually is a historian at the University of North Carolina, Charlotte, is coming out with a book about the Atlanta riot next spring. I've been in contact with him, so I really have to thank those historians who have done really the nitty-gritty archival work and have really given me the foundation to take a look at the narrative. Between mid-1905 and 1906, there was a very vicious gubernatorial Democratic primary going on in Atlanta. And as you know, the Democratic Party pretty much held the most power in the state of Georgia. So the primary was pretty much the election itself, because once he went against the Republican, surely the Democrat would win. So the Democratic primary involved two men. This one is Hoke Smith, who stood for the social reform wing of the party. He also was the editor of the Atlanta Journal, and he stood for social reform and populism. I'm going to come back to him in just a minute. This is his opponent, Clark Howell, who was editor of the Atlanta Constitution. Both of these men used their newspapers as sort of ways to promote their political platforms. Clark Howell stood for conservative interests, and in a nutshell, Clark Howell really just wanted to bring in business and commercial interests into Atlanta, to continue to make Atlanta the center of New South commerce, and he felt that if there was further racial polarization in the state of Georgia, that in fact businesses would not be interested in investing in the city. So he was mainly interested in industrializing the city. And Hoke Smith attacked him and said that he was an agent for the corporations and that he was being paid off by, like, the railroad companies. And Hoke Smith, on the other hand, characterized himself as a champion for the common man and said that he stood for the agrarian population and for people whose interests would not be focused upon in the new industrial South. In order to do that, Hoke Smith aligned himself with this man, Tom Watson, who had formerly been a member of Congress for one term. He was a populist, and when Tom Watson had won for Congress, he had actually tried to integrate the Democratic Party, because his feeling was that if you ignore the black vote, because as most of you know, with the 15th Amendment, African-American men have been granted the vote, right? And Tom Watson suggested that if you ignored the black vote, that it would in fact become a swing vote, and the Republican Party would be able to win and take over the South. And so what he had tried to do was to align populists among class lines, such as farmers who were disgruntled about the rapid mechanization of the South and African-American men. But he had done that unsuccessfully, but still maintained a large constituency of working-class whites. So what Hope Smith did was to address Tom Watson's constituents and align himself with Tom Watson, and Watson actually endorsed him. Howell tried to fight it. He rebutted the accusations that he was an agent for the railroads and for the corporations. But in fact, Hoke Smith did win the election running on a platform of black disfranchisement, because while he addressed Watson's constituents, instead of trying to integrate the populists or the Democratic Party, he said that we need to disfranchise blacks altogether, so then we don't have to worry about anything. And Hoke Smith, in fact, won. And in 1908, later after the riot, voting rights in, say, Georgia would become severely restricted for blacks. So the gubernatorial or Democratic primary really contributed to a climate of racial hatred in Atlanta at the time. Also, blacks understood that they really faced an imminent loss of political power. While they had faced such threats before, they understood that this one was actually real this time. So you had this climate of race baiting, racial hatred that had been engendered by the gubernatorial campaign. And then you had Thomas Dixon's play, The Klansman. This is the frontispiece of his novel that came out in 1905. But as some of you may know, the play was eventually made into Birth of a Nation, the 1915 movie that completely was the embodiment of a revival of the Ku Klux Klan in terms of protecting white womanhood. While before the movie came out, Thomas Dixon actually wrote the novel and also subsequently a play. When it opened in Atlanta, it opened to great applause, and this is sort of a blurred newspaper article, but you can see the title where it says, Birth of the Nation Thrills Tremendous Atlanta Audience. And this contributed to the racial hysteria in Atlanta. The play pretty much said that African-American men were sexually aggressive, and that the North and the South needed to unite in order to protect white women who would eventually be raped or threatened by African-American men. And if you know the history of that, part of the idea was that social equality was equal to a kind of social rape, that if African-Americans gained social equality, then the next thing you knew, black men would want to marry white women. So Birth of a Nation opened in Atlanta that year, and also, this is just a frontispiece from the 1915 movie, which is, of course, a lot later, but I just wanted to show it for some of you who don't know. And you see in the center of the poster is a hooded Klans member, but B.W. Griffith. How many of you have seen that? Okay. You haven't. Try to see that. So another thing that contributed, and here's a newspaper article where you can sort of see, this is an Atlanta newspaper in August 1906. Ku Klux Klan to protect women is now proposed. The KKK had declined since the end of Reconstruction, and it began to really sort of enjoy a resurgence after the Klansman play opened, particularly once Birth of a Nation opened in 1915. Eventually, after the riot and after everything that happened in Atlanta during this period, Klansmen would gain great power in the state of Georgia and would be elected to offices. But at this time, you see this sort of resurgence, this call to reorganize the KKK, and that's from an Atlanta newspaper. Another thing that contributed to the racial hysteria of Atlanta at the time were these incendiary newspaper articles, the Atlanta Evening News, the Georgian, the Constitution, all of them printed articles about supposed rapes. Now, at the time in Georgia, it was also considered to be rape if you had the intent to rape a white woman, and it had actually been a proposal in the state legislature to make it a capital offense to intend to rape. And so here you have some of the women say they were actually raped. Some of them were frightened. In one instance, I remember a man wandered into the house of a woman, and she was at home alone with her children, who was apparently drunk and had been in the saloons, and he was charged with rape. But some of them, the women actually claimed that they were assaulted. And these newspaper articles came out every day, black being surrounded by posse. And if you look through the newspapers of this time, all of the Georgia newspapers, they're just replete with these articles about black men assaulting or being attacked by mobs who were retaliating for the attacks. And earlier in the summer in Atlanta, when one of the men who had been accused of rape was lynched, the newspapers condoned it and said that, you know, this was justice served. This is another one, Robert Branham, who's accused the Mrs. Lawrence of raping two women who were visiting Atlanta at the time. So you can see how Mrs. J.A. Kimball will be attacked by a black bean. And this is even showing even more of the hysteria. Six-year-old Negro boy insulted little girl. These are the kinds of racial hysteria, the very incendiary articles. And later, after the riot was over, people would admit, both black and white, that the newspapers played a fundamental role in fomenting racial hysteria in Atlanta. And that here you see at the top, county police forces traveled to protect women from Negroes. And then here, this is a statement by the sheriff, would kill every Negro to protect our women. That was the sheriff of Atlanta at the time, John Nelms. And then here you see, vigilance committee is being organized. And that was the kind of things that they were doing in order. Here's $1,600 reward to capture Negro. I mean, this is the front page of the news. And clearly half of the paper is devoted to the apprehension of black criminals. And that was August something of the summer. And the riot, by the way, occurred September 22nd, which we're going to get to in a moment. Here we have another one, girl jumps into closet to escape Negro brute. So you continuously have these articles. And this is just showing for a moment what was going on in the black press in Atlanta. And this is taken from Voice of the Negro, which was a militant African-American journal published in Atlanta at the time. And it's kind of interesting, the caption here, let me see what the caption read, because you can't see it here. It said, the modern Caucasian's cross or the black man's burden. And so you have like this black man carrying the cross. And here you have pictured, this is Thomas Dixon, the author of The Klansman. This is John Temple Graves, who was the editor of the Atlanta Georgian, who was very much a white supremacist in Atlanta. This is James Bardeman, who was the governor of Mississippi at the time, who made very incendiary remarks. And then there is Senator Ben Tillman of South Carolina, who also was known to make remarks like, all Negroes need to be killed off or sent off. This is Hoke Smith, who was the governor-elect, or who would soon be the governor of Georgia. And there's Tom Watson, the populist who he aligned himself with. And then here you have a Democratic donkey, and it's labeled Italia, you know, and others. And then in the middle, you have this very scary picture. It says Teddy R. Teddy Roosevelt. And if you'll recall, the summer before this happened, the Brownsville affair happened in Brownsville, Texas, in which black soldiers who were stationed there were accused of rioting or invading the town and shooting up a place of business. And without ever being tried for that crime, Teddy Roosevelt dismissed them without honor. And it was very controversial because many of the men had been in the military for 30, 40 years and were due their pensions very soon. And they were dismissed without honor, and so they were entitled to none of that. And none of them ever admitted, the commanding officer said they were all in the barracks that night. There was never any proof about whether or not they did that. And later, like in the 1970s, there were investigations and federal commissions established to try to determine if they were guilty, and it was determined that they were not. And some of the families, there was only one living survivor, I think, but some of them got like back pension, which now is like nothing compared to what it would have been for them then. So it's very controversial. And I've been really interested in what like contemporary biographers of Teddy Roosevelt are saying about that. This is actually a 1919 image of Atlanta, so it's a little far off from where we are now. But I'm still waiting for my map, actually, from the Fulton County Library. But I just thought this was interesting because this is the district where the riot happened. And you can't really see it, but this is Peachtree Street coming down here. And this is Decatur Street. Part of the dissension about the riot was that it happened near this drinking district. And this drinking district had all of these saloons and brothels, and et cetera, that catered to a black and an interracial clientele. And so part of the sort of temperance part of the equation was that this was the cause of black criminality, drunkenness, drugs, licentiousness, et cetera. And the thing that struck me about this picture, the reason why I put it in the slideshow, is that this is like the heart of the downtown area. And some scholars have argued, not just in this riot, but also like if you're talking about Tulsa, 1921, or if you're talking about Wilmington, 1898, Wilmington, North Carolina, the black districts were in key areas. And so part of the outrage, they say, was over black visibility and also over black progress. In some instances, if it were like in Tulsa, it was what they call the Black Wall Street, right? In which you had very prosperous businesses that were burned down during that riot. So the thing that sort of struck me about that was that it's the heart of the downtown area. And then over here, you can't really see it, we're going to talk about it in a minute, is Five Points, which is still there in Atlanta. I'm going to have to defer to you and Lisa about that, but Atlanta expert here. But that's where all of the trains converged, the ones that came, all of the trolley cars that came in from the suburbs and from all over the city. And that's where the mob was particularly vicious. They pulled people off the trolley cars and beat them to death. And it's also where some of the mob or some of the white men who heard about the riot came in and ended up at Five Points and got off the trolley and sort of joined the melee. This is a contemporary map of downtown Atlanta, and I really just wanted to look at this because I don't know Atlanta that well, so I wanted to see for myself how this will work because some of these streets still go in the same directions. So here you have Decatur Street, and there's Five Points Station. And here's Peachtree coming down here. This is where, also where Pryor Street is right here, intersects. And you can see like in relation to like where everything is in downtown Atlanta today, where that riot occurred. And that's always kind of interesting to me, and I think it's probably interesting to historians, to go in a city and sort of know that this is the street, and this is the place where all of that happened, and there's no monument. There was a monument right near here on Marietta Street. I don't know where it is. Where's Marietta Street? Somewhere in there, there's a monument to Henry Grady, who was a famous newspaper man. He's supposed to be the person who coined the term New South. Okay. And that monument, which still exists today, was where they mutilated bodies and hung body pieces and put dead men under it. And as far as I know, I don't know if there's a riot monument to that. So this was just kind of interesting to me to see where this happened in relation. And we're going to talk in a minute about Brownsville, which was the southeast suburb where an African-American community that was attacked on the Monday of the riot. And that is going to be down that way off the map. So I know it's, you can't see it that well, but this is just to give you some idea. You see Georgia State there, City Hall, Clark, Morehouse building. This is the type of trolley car that converged at Five Points Station. So, as I said, and the trolley cars were segregated, but what they would do is they would tell all the whites to get off the car, and then they would beat the blacks to death. And when I was talking about this once, someone, I said, you know, this is one of the most vicious riots of the Progressive Era, and somebody said, well, how many people were killed? You really can't judge by the number of people killed, because one, we don't know, because there were all kinds of cover-ups as to how many people were killed exactly. And if you look at the newspaper accounts, it varies quite widely, even though the most I've seen in newspaper quote is 40 African Americans killed. But in terms of blacks who were killed, and also in terms of whites who were killed, we really don't know. But one of the things that we do know is the viciousness of the mob, because many of the people who were beaten, who were pulled off the trolley cars, literally like had their skin torn from their bodies and they were mutilated. So a lot of the mobbers were, the only thing they had were like sticks and clubs and things like that and homemade weapons. A lot of them didn't get guns, so it was really the nature of the killings that was so vicious. And this is the intersection of Five Points, and you really can't see, but you can sort of see in the bottom left-hand corner the trolley tracks, but this is an image around that time period of just sort of a couple of businesses that exist at that place where all of those streets converge. And I just thought it was quite interesting. The Atlanta newsstand is right there. So if you wanted to get an incendiary newspaper, you get it right there and join the mob. Because on the day that the riot started, which was Saturday, September 22nd, 4 evening extras came out for the fourth grades. And was being distributed among the crowd, and people saw these, and they really started to say, okay, we have to do something about this, and they got really upset. They were saying that 4 rapes had happened in one day. That was what the newspapers were. And then this is the Grady Monument that I was talking about. This is Marietta Street, and that is where they pulled men out of some of these black businesses, and they pulled a couple of barbers out of one of the barber shops, and they shot them dead, and then they pulled them, and then they just kind of threw them up against the statue. You can't really see the sign. I'll go in closer. It's a saloon on Decatur Street. This is one of the types of saloons that were targeted in terms of being a cause of the riot. Some of these saloons were white establishments. Some of them appealed to an interracial clientele. Some of them were strictly black. After the riot, a lot of them would have their licenses revoked, but most of the ones that had their license revoked appealed to a black or an interracial clientele. And that was one of the controversies in the city hall meetings that happened. After the riot, like why were the white saloons allowed to remain open and the black saloons closed? So this is a kind of very blurred image, but you can see the saloon there. After the riot, this area usually on the street, there would be something like 1,500 blacks milling around. After the riot, it was completely deserted because everybody was in hiding. And here's a newspaper article that says, Negro dives and clubs are the cause of frequent assaults. And they're saying that black criminality really was sort of birthed in the dives and the saloons. And so that was what was blamed. And just to speak on that just a moment, there had been, you know, Du Bois was a professor at Atlanta University at the time, and he was holding these conferences every year, the Atlanta University conferences. And actually, in 1904, it had a conference on black criminality, and it published on it and admitted that there was an issue that needed to be dealt with. So you had, even on the part of people who were doing work on it and investigating it, there was an admission on the parts of class that there was a problem, but the extent to which that problem was more than it was for white communities or white men in the same age range, I'm not certain. So, you know. And that was another thing. When the riot started, these saloons, there was state law that all of the saloons had to close at 10 o'clock. So basically, when the riot started at like 10:30, the saloons had just closed, and a lot of the white males who participated, and studies have shown that riots are overwhelmingly, riot mobs are overwhelmingly male, so I'm not just saying that. But you had a lot of these men coming out of these saloons and joining the fracas, and a lot of them were drunk. And so that was also a way in which there was this scapegoating strategy used afterwards, that really the mobbers were just a bunch of drunk dudes. But then it was the black saloons that were blamed. So the riot started on the night of Saturday, September 22nd, 1906, and you had all of these men gathering in the street. Actually, by 10:30 that night, they said there were 10,000 white men roaming the streets, armed, clubbing blacks, beating them. Some reports that I've read in newspapers have said there were 15,000 white men. As I said, they came in from the suburbs and from all over the city to Five Point Station and disembarked from the trolley cars and began to join the fracas. So at about midnight on Saturday night, Sunday morning, having a look at it, the governor of Georgia, who at the time was Joseph Terrell, called in the state militia. And these are images that were published in Harper's Weekly. You can see there on the left side, those are state troops who are in the streets. And I just have a couple of these images. Here's another one. You can see them in the middle. And you can see also that there were still whites who sort of milled around and really kind of ignored them, because it was really assumed that these troops were there to police blacks and not to really do anything to the whites. So while you still had white people sort of out and about during this time, many of the black community were in hiding. And these are all published in Harper's Weekly. This is another one. And it's really interesting when I see these, a lot of times they're posing. Some reports said that it was 600 state troops sent into Atlanta, and then others say that there were as many as 3,000 who eventually arrived in the city. And there's another one. You can barely see them. They're sort of right here in the bottom right-hand corner. They have the hats on. Stockyards, and apparently this was the route that many of the blacks took to escape the mob. So this is northeast of the city, if I'm corrected. They sort of went through the stockyards to try to escape the fury of the mob. Eventually, the reason that the riot stopped was because they couldn't find anybody else to beat, because people were gone and in hiding, and you know, they just really couldn't find anybody. And then the violence quieted down on Sunday, but again erupted on Monday in the middle-class black suburb of Brownsville. And this is really what the post-riot dialogue centers upon, because Brownsville is where Gammon Theological Seminary was, and also Clark University. And it was considered to be a middle-class African-American community. On Monday, the men in Brownsville, the police, it was already a very small number of police in the city, as it were, at the time, which was also a problem in many urban areas. As people came into the cities, there was just not enough police. So the men in Brownsville, the African-American men, decided to arm themselves to prepare for defense in case they were attacked by the mob, because rumors came that the mob was going to come, because the riot went on all day Sunday, and then on Monday, they started to arm themselves. Where did they get the guns? Well, according to some reports, they smuggled them in through the Undertaker in coffins, because they couldn't buy them in Atlanta. The ammunition shops wouldn't sell them. So reportedly, they smuggled in ammunition and they began to arm themselves. At the same time, the police heard a rumor that blacks in Brownsville were arming themselves and preparing for retaliation for what had gone on in the previous day. So a group of plainclothes officers go into Brownsville to allegedly break up whatever reprisal was being planned, and to arrest the leaders. And when they go in, they are fired upon by what they call a black posse. And one of the officers is killed. And it was sort of a full-scale war in terms of law enforcement on this community of Brownsville. The Brownsville homes were raided for ammunition, and many of them, as you can see here, this is actually a raid, even though some people said they're posing for the picture, but this is actually a raid of Brownsville home. They went in the homes, they ransacked them looking for ammunition, and they confiscated anything that they found. Eventually, they rounded up 257 men in Brownsville, some of whom were professors, students, doctors. One of them was the postmaster of the community, and marched them through the streets quite sort of shamefully, and took them down to the tower, which was the jailhouse. Eventually, 75 men were put into the jail. The others were released. But 60 men were indicted for the murder of this police officer, 60 African-American men from Brownsville, yeah. And part of the outrage was over the fact that this was a middle-class African-American community. And people felt that, you know, Booker T. Washington had been promoting the self-help ideology and the idea that if you had economic progress, that then it would translate into social progress. And part of what happened here was that you had this sort of critical disjuncture between the notion of social equality and material progress. So this is really what many, particularly the African-American narrators who talk about the riot afterwards, will be concerned with, what happened in Brownsville. And here's another picture. These are troops sitting on the porch of a house in Brownsville. And as you can see, the thing that sort of strikes me about it is they're just sort of comfortably hanging out there. So many people just felt that, you know, their women were frightened by the troops, the homes were ransacked and torn up. And in some instances in newspaper articles, it says that if they came in and somebody was like lying in bed wounded, they assumed that they had been part of the posse that had attacked the police officers, and they killed them right there in the home. So that happened a couple of times. This is Jackson Row. This is another African-American community that was invaded by the mob, and I just wanted to show how the mob really sort of fanned out from the downtown area and really began to attack these residential districts. Okay, and then this part of the presentation, I wanted to talk about who were the major players in the post-riot discourse, who responded to it, and what did they say? I eventually, you know, when I first saw what had happened and sort of began to learn the history, I had this very sort of romantic notion, as many graduate students do, of finding African-American riotators who had protested against the riot and who said that these allegations of black criminality were false, and then white narrators who said that it was justified and that it was punishment for black criminals. But what I found actually was a much more complex straddling, and this is why we can't get too emotionally involved in the work, but you know, it's hard. So what I found was that there was a really sort of complex straddling that both whites and blacks found themselves in terms of blaming, in terms of desiring causes, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to talk about that, and I just wanted to start by saying that, you know, I'm not really sort of establishing a strict binary between people who were pro-riot or anti-riot, because in actuality, in the dialogues, it was a little bit more complicated. This is from a Parisian weekly, what was it called, Le Petit Parisien, I think. And it was interesting, there were a couple of French weeklies who reported on the riot, and they had these amazing illustrations, and this is one of them. And the thing I sort of noticed about it is that they call this a lynching in the United States. And we could talk about lynching and how I sort of avoid that. But as you can see from the picture, the men are actually, the white men are aggressively slaying the black men, and these men here are black men on the ground, and here you see this guy beating him, and then the image up there, you can't really see, it's a white man pushing a black man off the roof. So very much, at least in the French press, and it was the same sort of thing with the other French weeklies, there was this portrayal of the riot as particularly anti-black, although we know in the U.S. press it was not as clear-cut as that. Particularly in the southern newspapers, you had these justifications for the riot and that it was a punishment for criminals. So, who were the major players? Here is Francis Grimké, who, and I'm always really intrigued by the Grimkés. As you know, he was the son of the South Carolinian slaveholder Henry Grimké, who had also had two well-known white female abolitionists, Angelina and Sarah, by his white wife. But he had, Francis Grimké was a pastor at 15th Street Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., and he was known for being very vocal about racial issues. So he spoke out about the riot in a sermon that was delivered 2 weeks after October 7th. And basically what Grimké says is that African-American criminals do exist, right? But he asked, what have I to do with the black criminal? And so what you had was these sort of black middle-class leaders who wanted to distance themselves from, you know, this notion of black criminality. And he also says that blacks are somewhat like the Apostle Paul in the sense that they are persecuted. He said sometimes the higher the type represented, the more persecuted you become. And he said Paul was in danger of rivers and robbers and his own countrymen, and in the same way African Americans are. And so he sort of posits this image of African American victims as martyrs. And he says that we have to continue to progress because that is really the only antidote. And he says that, you know, middle-class progressive blacks disprove notions of black inferiority, so we have to continue to work on that. But definitely the issue at stake for Grimké was whether or not progressive or so-called progressive blacks would be held accountable for the sins of the few. And that's really sort of the complex straddling that I wanted to mention, is that many of the African-American middle-class leaders felt that they did not want to be lumped in with the masses of black people who may have been committing crimes. This is Ray Stannard Baker, who was a muckraking journalist. He went south from New York to Atlanta to investigate the riot, and he wrote a series of magazine articles in American McClure's magazines that were published between October 1906 and September 1907. Eventually, they were collectively put in a volume called Following the Color Line, Negro Citizenship in the Progressive Era. There's several copies of Following the Color Line here at the Young Research Library. It's really fascinating. But basically, Grimke found himself wanting to defend Atlanta as a progressive city, and he uses the scapegoating strategy that I talked about earlier. He says that the riot mob really consisted of low-life criminals, both black and white, and that the more representative people in the city are white and black progressives who really represent what Atlanta is all about. He said that after the riot, middle-class leaders, black and white, had worked very hard to restore civic cooperation, and that this was the spirit of the city. So his entire argument really rested on the scapegoating strategy and what Alex Swan has called the riffraff theory of riot participation, which is interesting because that's sort of the same thing they used with the LA riots of 1992, that it was just the riffraff who participated in that, you know, middle class people had nothing to do with it. And I'm going very quickly over these people because right now I'm going to go very unfairly quickly over Booker T. Washington. You know, how can you do that? Well, you know, can't do it all. But Booker T. at the time was in New York at the time of the riot. And as you know, this was also the time that the cleavage between Booker T. and Du Bois was really starting to widen. And Du Bois was finding himself less and less tolerant of a Washingtonian theories of uplift. So they were really starting to go at it, even though they had made all of these attempts to sort of connect over the years since Du Bois left Harvard, they were really starting to disagree. And so at the time, Booker T. was in New York, and he wrote a brief statement and said that, you know, blacks don't retaliate, that's not the thing to do right now, so we need to work in peace and harmony. And he also ended up in December 15 publishing an article in The Outlook in which he said that, you know, one of the good things that came out of the riot is that you do have this renewed cooperation between blacks and whites in the city, and that this shows that my theories of white beneficence and black self-help ideology really do work. So we can talk about him in the question and answer period. This is J. Max Barber, who was editor of the Voice of the Negro magazine that I mentioned, the militant African-American journal in Atlanta. Very interesting figure in and of himself, which I can't really go into all of it, but he was very unequivocal about what he thought about the riot and what he thought about the allegations of rape. He said that the rapes were really just cases of white female fright, that there was never any physical contact. He wrote an article in Voice of the Negro later, the month after, and said that he really sort of described in these macabre, dark, sort of carnivalesque terms of savages and these sort of evil savages beating up these innocents, right? And he also published an article anonymously in the New York World because John Temple Gray, the editor of the Atlanta Morning, who I mentioned before, had sent a letter to the New York World and said, you know, the Atlanta riot will rid Atlanta of black crime in the next 5 years. And he contested that, wrote anonymously, but he was subsequently outed. And some people say he was outed by the telegram office. And he was run out of town, literally, and was not even able to get his printing press and all of that. And went to Chicago. So the riot happened in September. I think it's November. The next issue comes out because it's a monthly, and it comes from Chicago. And he's very upset about it. But eventually, Booker T. the Wizard will get to him and destroy his career when he betrays him. This is the Atlanta University class of 1916. And I want to mention real briefly Walter White, who's pictured right here. And some of you may know he eventually became an administrator in the NAACP, but he was living in Atlanta at the time of the riot. He was only 13 years old. The night of the riot, his father was a mail collector. He goes out with him on a mail collecting run, and his family was very light-skinned, and Walter White had blue eyes, you know, was able to pass quite easily. And so he and his father were not bothered, and he witnessed a lot of the brutality, and was really surprised at what was happening. And when they go back home, the mob is coming into their neighborhood. And his father, and this is something that he recounts in his autobiography, which actually wasn't published until years later, like 1948, so it really doesn't fit into my focus on immediate post-riot publishing. But I just wanted to mention Walter White, because he starts the autobiography out with this and describes it as his sort of racial awakening. He and his father arm themselves at the window. They send the women to the back, and they see the mob coming. And his father, he says, turns to him and says, "When the first one steps foot on the lawn, shoot. And don't you miss." And he was 13. And he said he just realized what it meant. He had enjoyed the sort of middle-class white picket fence existence, and he understood what it meant to be African American. But interestingly enough, he said that at that moment he also decided that he wanted to cast his lot with these people and help them. This is Kara Clifford, who has a poem on the handout that I gave you, and I'm not going to probably get a chance to talk about her a little bit, but she's who I'm currently working on. I'm really fascinated by her. She's one of the few African-American women to participate in the post-riot discourse, and at the time of the riot, lived in Washington, D.C., was very involved in the intellectual activity of D.C., and wrote a poem called Atlanta Shame, which is on your handout, and she also wrote an article in response to John A.J. McElway, who was a leading progressive, and also Edward Ware, who was the president of one of the Atlanta colleges, I can't remember which one. But she was very, just like Barbara, very radical, about as radical as Du Bois and Barbara were on this issue. And her voice just stands out as clearly angry, clearly militant. She published a couple of volumes of poetry, and I actually recently found her great-granddaughter. And so I have been leaving messages with her, trying to get her. She's got the page, she's got all her stuff, so I'm hoping that I might find out a little more. I know. People. Okay. And then finally, I'll end the slideshow with just a picture of Du Bois, who we're going to talk about his poem for just a moment. And this was appropriately taken in 1908. And at the time of the riot, Du Bois was actually in Alabama working on a federal peonage study for the U.S. Census Bureau of sharecropping and tenant farming. And he raced home on a train, and while he was on the train, he wrote the poem, A Litany of Atlanta. And his wife and his daughter, Nina and Yolande, were back at the dormitory where they lived at Atlanta University. He goes back, and he gets a shotgun and sits on the steps, ready in case anybody comes. And it's funny because Booker T. Washington criticizes him, because actually he left 8 days later and went back. And Booker T. Washington, after 2 days after the riot, came down from New York and stayed a couple of days and then went on down to Tuskegee. He criticized Du Bois and said, you know, he ran and he was scared and he didn't come down and deal with it when it got tough. But, you know, I mean, very much, I think Du Bois was experiencing a critical moment in his outlook, partly because this was right at the heart of him trying to get the Niagara Movement going. And they had just had a meeting at Harper's Ferry earlier that summer. He was very excited about that. They had 200 members already. And he was about to call in 1907 a meeting in Boston. So this riot, I think, was very hurtful to him in terms of what happened. And, you know, also, I mean, he was an intellectual first, always. So let's talk about the poem a little bit. Does everybody have a copy? Share. There's some of you. Okay. 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 And I sort of envision this to be interactive. This is a fairly long poem. It's not the best length of poem or run the cycle. But, you know, the litany is very widely anthologized in New York, and a lot of people teach it, a lot of students have contact with it. So my hope was that either you had had some previous contact with it, or you just read quickly. Interestingly enough, Du Bois uses the form of a litany, an evangelical litany. And as you know, that's a group responsive prayer in which a leader sort of petitions an audience and then they respond with a choral refrain. And it's just really interesting to me because, as you know, Du Bois was not very religious and chose to publish this poem, or to write this poem at this time, which deals with this kind of ambivalence to this God figure who is either sleeping or dead. If we just can just sort of go through the stanzas from the beginning of the poem, we see that he turns to a spiritual deity in order to vocalize his protest. He reaches out to this God who he believes refuses to act. And repeatedly in the choral response, he asks for this God to hear him, to listen, to say something. And interestingly enough, throughout the poem, he sets up this kind of binary between us and they. And so one of the things that sort of strikes me about it is that he aligns himself quite strongly with an African-American community and against a sort of white mobber. So there's this real strict binary between the us and the them, whites and blacks. And it really, really refuses, I think, to acknowledge any kind of interracial cooperation. It's a sort of us versus they pronoun usage in it. In the third stanza, which I've highlighted, he talks about the same sort of thing that Remke was concerned about and other intellectuals such as Henry Hugh Proctor and some of the ones that I didn't get a chance to mention. He says, when our devils do deviltry, curse thou the doer of the deed. Curse them as we curse them. But in the next stanza, he says, and yet whose is the deeper guilt? Who made these devils? And so part of what he's saying here is that even though there are black criminals, look at the example that whites have set in terms of enslaving African Americans, in terms of bought and sold them, waxed fat and rich on public iniquity, he says. So part of what he says is, yes, okay, there are black criminals, but look at the example that has been set, and look at the ways in which white people have been criminals themselves. And then he says, is this thy justice, O Father, that guile be easier than innocence, and the innocent crucified for the guilt of the untouched guilty? And right now I'm in the fifth stanza. So, like I said, part of what he's concerned about is innocence being persecuted for the few, for the sins of the few. And then in the next two stanzas, he very interestingly, first, he sort of wavers between God being dead or God just being far away and not really caring about what's going on. He says, is not the God of the fathers dead? And he sort of flirts with this sort of there is no God sort of idea. But in the next one, in the next stanza, he says, thou art not dead, but flown afar of hills of endless light. So it's very interesting to me that on the one hand, he sort of flirts with this idea that there is no God, and then another one, that there is a God, but he really just doesn't care. Herbert Shapiro has actually said that one of the things that the litany does is to raise the question of whether or not the American conscience was dead, and that really the sort of God figure is a metaphor for the American conscience, which I think is pretty interesting. And then in the last three stanzas on that page, he asks for deliverance, I mean, to the extent that there are sins being committed by African Americans, to the extent that there are these vices within the community, he asks for deliverance from those. And then on the next page, in the second stanza, he, on the third line of the second stanza, he again refers to the hypocrisy of whites. He says, cease from crime, and he puts it in italics for emphasis. The word was mockery, for thus they train 100 crimes, while we do cure one. And so, again, he refers to this kind of hypocrisy, like, okay, who are you to judge? And really, I sort of phrase it as, he talks about the lack of moral authority that whites have, particularly after this riot, to talk about black criminality. And that, to me, also seems to be like a central concern. Feel free to interrupt me. Okay. And then in the third stanza, which I've also highlighted, this is where he directly addresses Booker T. Washington's theories of social uplift. He says, behold this maiming broken thing. Dear God, it was an humble black man who toiled and sweat to save a bit from the pittance paid him. They told him work and rise. He worked. Did this man sin? Nay, but someone told how someone said another did. And so here he talks about how part of the reason that the Washingtonian theories of uplift don't work is because when it comes to race in America, you know, individuals are not held, and it's always the group. And so for one person to progress, it doesn't mean anything because people are always going to be held accountable as a group. And I think that's one of the things that he's saying. And so he also says that, and this is, when I say he, I'm really talking about the narrator, says that the narrator may not be able to achieve this American success narrative precisely because of the way that race functions in this country. And then in the next couple of paragraphs, he becomes very angry. And the way that I really think of this poem is that it kind of has a crescendo, and then an explosion, and then a decrescendo. And this is right at the moment where I think the poem explodes, right? Because he becomes very angry. He says, pile the pale frenzy of blood-crazed root who do such deeds high on thine altar, Jehovah Jireh, and burn it in hell forever and ever. And then, just as soon as he says this, a couple of stanzas down, he says, forgive the thought, forgive these wild blasphemous words. So, There's this frustration, but there's also this shifting back and forth between sort of this provocation of this God figure and also this kind of humility to a potential power that this God figure may have to intervene in his life. And it sort of goes back and forth between these two ideas of provocation and also sort of humility. If you look at the next page, the last page of the poem, he asks this God figure to point us to a path. Where do we go? In the north there's greed, in the south there's blood. Whither? To death, right? So again, that's part of the dark image of the poem. The only sort of reprieve from this is it death, right? Is it another life? And he says, not this life, dear God, not this, right? And thank goodness he lived a long time, was able to see some of his dreams come to fruition. But he starts to decrescendo in the poem, and you still have these images of light and dark, life and death, like with the star. That's sort of a light, but then also he's talking about the night, so it's very dark. And then when he mentions the sobbing of women and children, it seems to me to be an image of regeneration, and perhaps there being a sort of another cycle that will come forth. But at the same time, his confidence, I think, is very shaken in terms of hope. And this is a very interesting sort of time for him to write this poem, because like I said, the Niagara Movement had really been enjoying success, and they had signed the Declaration of Principles the year before, and were very excited. That was the most radical that Du Bois had been up until that time. And I think it's very interesting that he just feels this sort of overwhelming despondency, which is how I read it. So I'm going to end there and open up to any questions or comments.
You mentioned a book in the show. You mentioned a book is coming out in the fall, this late. What was the name?
I don't know the name of the book, but his name is Gregory Mixon. M-I-X-O-N. He's a historian at the University of North Carolina, Charlotte. And he wrote a fabulous dissertation about it, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what he's doing with the book, Gregory Mixon, M-I-X-O-N.
And you mentioned the lecture that the newspaper played an important role, critical role, in the riot. And in your observation, is there any neutral newspaper at that time reporting the riot?
Neutral as in not taking a side? Well, you know, interesting, the newspapers really flop back and forth sometimes. I mean, I've even looked at the LA Times here, and one minute you have them saying that blacks were mobbed and massacred, and the next minute you say that Negroes seize arms and attack whites. I don't think that, you know, the nature of journalism at this time is not to be neutral. Like, if you look at any of the, like, late 19th century newspapers, there is a strong editorial viewpoint in there.
At that time, is there any newspaper managed by African American?
Yeah, I mean, The Voice of the Negro was a monthly, which was sort of a newspaper. There was another newspaper in Atlanta, the Atlanta Independent, or The Independent, that the Du Bois poem originally appeared in, and that was edited by Benjamin Davis. And that was not as radical as the Barber publication. It was a little bit more conservative. There were black newspapers. Most of them were weeklies, so sometimes it's quite difficult to sort of get up-to-the-minute information because they don't come out until Saturday, so you have to wait till the following Saturday. So, yeah, there were newspapers throughout.
The black man that you talked about who had the radical black newspaper who fled to Chicago, what was his name again?
J. Max Barber, Jesse Max Barber.
Barber, and did he stay, just finish out his career in Chicago?
You know, he was a member actually of the original 29 men who went to Niagara Falls with Du Bois, mm-hmm. And he did several things that angered Booker T. Washington, and so basically Booker T. Washington iced him, mm-hmm. And the journal Voice of the Negro eventually died in Chicago because he couldn't regain the momentum that he had in Atlanta, and then he ended up moving to D.C. and becoming like a school principal, but according to some reports, Washington made him lose his job like a couple of times. So he ends up becoming a dentist.
Dentist.
Why do you hesitate to call it these mild riots and lynchings?
Well, you know, I mean, because it's really hard, I think, to separate out types of violence. And particularly with riot mobs, there were lynchings within the riot mobs. I mean, people were lynched during the Atlanta riot. And quite often in this kind of mob behavior, the two overlap. So that's something that I really struggle with, how to talk about riots without talking about lynchings, because it's a whole nother discourse, and it's a whole nother thing. And I just think that if we're going to talk about forms of interpersonal violence, and particularly if we're going to try to figure out how these are precursor to current violent protest riots, there's some utility in looking at them separate from lynchings. But I think it's quite interesting that the French Weekly called it a lynching and used that term more broadly. I mean, my distinction would be that the level of threat was higher into more members of the community with a riot mob than with a lynching. Lynchings tended to be individual, sort of framed around crimes, etc. And here you had none of the men who were suspects of the rapes were attacked by the mob. They were all regular people. Yeah, so I think there's some value in separating the two out. But that's a question I get asked a lot, and I'm still worrying. And I really don't think there's an easy answer to it, because they do overlap.
I'm interested in the middle class distancing from criminality in the Black community, because that's something that resonates today.
Right.
But I'm wondering, were there voices, or perhaps there wasn't access to voice, of alternative visions, like, no, we need to reject criminality altogether, that's not what this is about racism, or...
You mean saying that the criminality didn't exist, or that it was...
Right, not excusing, not saying, okay, well, yeah, we have criminals amongst us, but don't lump us all in with that, but rejecting kind of that discourse at all.
Right. I don't think it was necessarily an alternative viewpoint. I mean, I would call it a radical viewpoint, because so many people straddled the fence on this. Partly it was because people were frightened. I mean, a lot of these people left Atlanta, who were, like, Barber left, you know, if Du Bois is going to leave in a couple of years. A lot of the people who were most melted, Carrie Clifford didn't live there. So these people, like Henry Crawford and William Jefferson White, they had to live in that city. So they were really just trying to figure out how to survive and prevent another attack. And that's another thing that people sort of tend to ignore, that the interracial cooperation after the riot was because the city really lost face in terms of its reputation. And it suffered economically from it. And that is a reason why, even though 60 men from Round 4 were indicted for the murder of the officer, only one or two, maybe, were actually convicted and sentenced to life in prison. The rest were eventually released, even though they may have stayed in jail for some time. So you did have people who admitted, like, you know, this was not about the rapes. This was about white supremacy. This was about this, that, and the rest, other than the rapes, because there was a question as to whether or not the rapes even happened. So, I mean, even in the scholarship now, you have this sort of unease or dis-ease with saying whether or not they were justified. But, like, I agree. Like, I don't think it was an issue of whether or not the rapes actually occurred or not, even if the men were guilty. Really, the issue was this kind of hatred that had been fomented by the play, by the gubernatorial race, by the disfranchisement, etc. So I would say that, yeah, they were. I would call them, like, radical, because so few people said that.
The College of Spelman, Morehouse, Clark, they have any response or any, well, what was their response? Did they, you know, come out and say anything?
Well, you know, one of the suspects rounded up in the Brownsville raid was the president of Gannon Theological Seminary, J.W. Bowen. That was a huge outrage. And also many of the suspects were professors and students from those colleges. So when I look at, like, what the newspapers were saying and what people were saying in their letters and what did Booker T. write, because J.W. Bowen wrote Booker T. There's a letter from him. They were like, let's just get back to school. It's because they were thinking that students were going to be frightened to come back on campus. So they were trying to say, it's safe now. Let's go back to school. Let's just put it behind us. There was this huge movement to kind of go on, to go forward, and not let it happen again.
Dolen, could you say a few words about the asymmetrical relationship of this discourse? Because one of the things that strikes me always in terms of what you're saying, kind of behind this, is the extreme difficulty to really have what we would think of in our terms of discourse.
Right.
One group being so silenced.
Right. Yeah, and that's particularly something that I found with women, wanting to know what women said and the voices just not being there. So it's not only is it highly asymmetrical in terms of gender and in terms of what they were saying, it's also symmetrical in terms of class. Most of the people who had access to the resources to say something and be heard were middle-class people. Mm-hmm. So there's a huge mass of people who are silenced, and so I just have to adjust my expectations of what I'm looking for, because sometimes it's just not there. But every time I find another female voice, like I recently found Eugenia Burns Hope wrote about it, John Hope's wife, it's very exciting. And I just think that there's something about it that's necessarily asymmetrical because of those factors, and you have to just be careful that we're not making claims in general about what people thought. No, specifically, these are what middle-class African-American intellectuals thought about it. And particularly, you know, even with Du Bois, part of his fear was that he, you know, intellectuals and educated African-Americans would be displaced under Washington's theories. And so, you know, that's part of the outrage over these professionals being attacked. And that's why they tend to focus on Brownsville much more than all of the beating that went down at Five Points. I mean, very little is said about Five Points and what happened in downtown.
And so the riots actually took, you know, a few days. When you talk about the riots in 1906, you're talking about, you know, quite a few days.
We're talking about, it started Saturday evening about 10 o'clock. It went through Sunday, quieted down some during the day on Monday, then the Brownsville attack. And then on Tuesday, the officers raid the Brownsville homes. On Thursday or Wednesday, you have a city hall meeting called emergency meeting, try to restore order. So we're really talking about like Saturday through Tuesday.
My question is dealing with, again, I'm sorry, I'm late.
That's okay.
With the aftermath, when you were in, what's the attitude among the people after the fast, after it was started, when it all ended?
Yeah.
But let's forget about what happened and put it behind us in space. There was no, like, I guess because I'm trying to ask, there was no kidding from other people to not necessarily put it behind it, but just talk about it more. There was no kind of action at all. They just, like, sat on it and forgot about it, or what?
I mean, you know, hey, a couple years later, Springfield erupts in violence, and so you have something else to talk about. Springfield, Ohio, which was largely used as a basis for the founding of the NAACP. I mean, I think that part of the problem was that before you could really deal with this, another one happened in another city, and it was an even greater danger. I mean, I think that in Atlanta, I mean, Washingtonian compromise won out because people wanted to restore order. And so you have ministers even saying, yes, I know, we need to arrest these criminals. One minister said that all the ministers in the city would cooperate with authorities to decrease black crime and just let us know how to do that. We'll arrest them. They even suggested putting black detectives on the police force to try to infiltrate the saloons and find out who the criminals were. I mean, at least in Atlanta, there was a huge push to make things normalized and return back to normal. I mean, because if you're thinking about 15,000 people, like, slaughtering, beating, clubbing old women, children, I mean, it's a very fearful climate in that way, especially when you have law enforcement who's not protecting you, and then all of a sudden you have these state troops who aren't on your side either. So imagine going against 15,000 people and then 3,000 state troops. You know, as one of my friends said, you know, they were always outnumbered and outgunned.
I can imagine that. That's why I asked the question.
Yeah.
Because the endurance of it all, you know, after it ended and all these kids were laying in the street days, sometimes for days after, there was a talk among the people to get them back. And the army, once they came in, it's the same kind of thing that happened there. Mm-hmm. Came to people's houses and they found people who were shot or kids that were shot or wounded. They thought they were part of their mob and shot, killed people. And so the official number of people that were killed came out by the government standards. It was way higher than that because he had instances where soldiers are coming looking for leaders, youth leaders, who helped organize this demonstration against Afrikaans language in the schools. Mm-hmm. And they would find a kid in the house that had been shot in the shoulder or the leg, and they would just kill him in front of their mom or dad. But I wanted to know psychologically about that, because it was a difference in our situation, because we didn't just say, well, let's forget about it, let's move on. At least I didn't, because I was like, even though I was shot, I was shot in the knee, I was like, I couldn't wait to get better so we could get back and get these guys. But it was a whole different thing. I just want to know that psychologically, how was it?
Well, you know, the interesting thing is, eventually that's what happens, and that's why riots transition to violent protest riots, right? Because eventually, I mean, and blacks fought back during this. I mean, there are rumors that there were many more whites killed, and the undertakers buried them in the black cemeteries to, like, hide it so that people wouldn't know, and it never came out. But eventually, particularly when you get into the red summer of 1919, you have incredible resistance to these attacks, and I think it takes a while. Particularly, I think it's, and some people would even say that's why the black soldiers were so threatened. Particularly, you know, when those soldiers came back from the war, they just weren't taking it. And, you know, when you look at the Tulsa riot, part of the reason why that happened is because they took a black man to jail. Black people in the community thought they were going to lynch him, and they went down there armed and said, release him. And the fight broke out.
They were just outnumbered.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Well, and I think also in Atlanta, at the black colleges there, it's changed now, obviously, but even in the 60s, and I think probably back then, they were very conservative, and they were kind of, you know, what you're saying, I know that was the way it was in the 60s, so I'm sure that's the way it was. Mm-hmm. They were kind of like, they didn't bring up a lot of, you know, keep stuff going.
Right.
So I think that was just the
You think compared to other southern cities, they were...
Yeah, I think Spelman and Morehouse were not like, you know, Tennessee State and Fisk as far as the civil rights movement.
Right.
It was a huge difference. I mean, North Carolina, you know, AT, Spelman and Morehouse were, they got involved, but they were a little quieter at first. And it was Nashville and North Carolina that really started. They were a little bit more conservative about this, especially, you know, Stone.
Yeah.
You know, women were not so vocal.
Right.
I mean, if you were, they were kind of asked to leave the school and things like that. You know, Alice Walker.
What kinds of ideas were the women, you know, invested in or had any voice at? Were they just basic ideas around sexual?
Well, both white and black women were very active in the COT movement, and that has been another thing that I've been looking into, the National Association of Colored Women, and just what were the chapters in Atlanta, both black and white women's clubs doing, and what were they talking about. So far, what I've found, at least for black women's clubs, they speak out more on lynching than riots, so there's a lot more on lynching. But very much there are these kind of middle class Victorian values of moralizing. So of course the women are very involved with temperance, and the women's Christian temperance movement is very strong at this time. And they were, you know, attempting to decrease alcoholism and civilize the young children. I mean, there was always this kind of moralizing piety
from the white women.
Both.
From
who? Because many of the African American women's clubs adopted much of what the white women's club. I mean, there were moments of overlap in terms of the issues they were concerned with.
So the middle class basically appropriated this and just ran with it. The voices were as they usually do.
Right. Because they were the ones that had access to. I mean, who else can write a letter to the New York World and have it published other than somebody with power?
Precedent for gaining access to non-middle class voices during this time period? I mean, maybe after the fact, but I'm thinking like some of the WPA interviews of people who survived in the time, or
Yeah, you know, I haven't looked at the WPA interviews only because...
You got enough to do?
Yeah, so, well, because I was looking at written narratives rather than oral narratives, and it becomes really difficult. And I was also looking at narratives that were published immediately after, and that was why I said Walter White doesn't really fit in. Because once you get into, like, retrospective accounts, you get into much more distortion. And so that was the only reason. And the WPA narratives were taken, like, in the, what, 1910s, 1920s?
Probably
the 30s. So I was thinking about that as, like, the distortion. And I also had, in my dissertation, done some retrospective accounts. And Richard Yarborough said, why are you doing this? You need to justify this. You need to tell me why you're doing this. And it didn't work. I couldn't justify it in terms of what I was trying to do. I only used it because it was good, and I didn't want to, like, exclude it, you know? But I was really more concerned with initial responses.
Because I was wondering if there were any such thing as church newsletters.
Right.
Which might be extinct. From the actual period.
Right. I mean, yeah, that's a good idea. That's digging. That's all I have to do.
That would be more archival.
Might
be some other voices in the church newsletter, possibly.
It's just shame. It's a shame, but it's difficult. Right. I mean, that's not. Yeah. That also is something that carries forward. Right?
Of course.
Right.
Who has access is who claims the story.
And, yeah, I think there's still a lot of digging that I have to do because I continue to find stuff. And then it becomes a matter of selection. So, can you think of a story that's going on?
Yeah, well, I think you definitely have to have, these things can go on forever, right, as far as you determining what sources you're going to give priority to, what, you know, detective work you're going to do as far as finding sources. But I think as far as the doability factor, and bringing closure to it. There are ways of, you know, making an argument and then making clear, you know, why you've chosen such sources, what you've extracted from them. Then leaving room to say, listen, further research.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah, because this can go on. Especially trying to find church newsletters. That sounds like really quite a task.
Yes.
Especially if there isn't a depository already, where, you know, you'd have to find, I think that can be found out soon, but where would you start looking for church newsletters if they haven't been collected yet?
Yeah, unless you just had an extraordinary church that somehow had lasted
it would have been deposited, though, by now.
That would, to me, would seem easy, because Atlanta had a lot of those. I mean, you had
Hunter Street.
Mm-hmm. Ebenezer was around then.
Mm-hmm. But I don't know how they go back.
It would be falling apart right now unless
this is probably a naive question, but can you think of a time of riot used as a social protest where the middle class didn't appropriate, didn't make the statement after the
fact? A riot?
That used as a social protest and circumstances in the country.
I can.
Okay.
Well, I can.
Sure,
my country,
exactly.
Sophiatown, 1952.
It's the only example I can.
The middle class sat back and said, you know what? Because the younger people were like, the people in their 20s and in their teens was like, if we fall back now, they would do this over and over and over and over again. Yeah, it started out as a peaceful demonstration because the government had declared Sophiatown as a white area.
Which
you have to understand that during apartheid, if you were black and you lived on a piece of property that was desirable to the white government, they simply declared it a white area and they give you 24 hours to pack up everything you had and move out. And then within weeks, it became a white suburb. Mm-hmm. So what happened with Sophiatown in February 1952, who was the Minister of Housing then? Former Prime Minister B.J. Vorster was the Minister of the Interior and Housing Development. He saw Sophiatown saw it as desirable, and he declared it as a whites-only area. The blacks, the younger blacks, was like, we're not moving, because you've done it in Cape Town, you've done it in Port Elizabeth, you've done it in East London,
doggone it, it's not going to happen here in Johannesburg. We're going to stand and we're going to stay right here. So they sent the army in. It started out with 69 women. Went to a local police station to protest. Signs saying this is not right, we're not leaving. Peaceful demonstration. The police panic, open fire. What you get? 69 dead black women. They came in with bulldozers the next day, but you can get that in the news. The next day, forced everyone out of their homes, burned down all the buildings, bulldozed the stuff away, and within 3 months, you had Grahamstown. That's where it is now, where Sophia Town used to be. There's a white suburb called Grahamstown. So that was a situation where the people would say it's like, they would have a demonstration, but it would be a non-violent demonstration. It started out with 69 women. And all 69 of these women got killed. But it was a non-violent protest. A social movement.
But still in that series, that's the middle class. The middle class was the leavening force, right?
The middle class didn't do anything. They sat back and said, well, the government has won. And they packed up all this stuff and they moved out.
I have a question just on another front. I think that what's really interesting about your work is it has a very strong interdisciplinary dynamic. And I want to know, as somebody who's sort of trained, you know, in English, right, how did you feel being a historian here? I think one of the real interesting dynamics is that folk from other disciplines end up bringing something very new to history when they encounter it, especially like people who are trained in literary studies, they pay attention to discourse more, things of those, a lot of things that we tend to overlook in our training as historians. So I want to get your, just a take on your experience in terms of crossing those disciplinary boundaries,
right.
Because as much as we argue against them, you know, we find ourselves oftentimes still very much limited in scope, you know, by those boundaries.
Well, you know, I read Hayden White and was inspired, because he said, you know, a historian is nothing but a person writing a narrative as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I just had to ignore it because, you know, I was telling Regina this, I always get historical questions.
Mm-hmm.
So there was really no way for me to ignore the history.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to sort of ignore the distinctions and
mm-hmm.
just cross them. You know, I thought you were about to ask me how I was crossing genre, which is a whole other thing, because
right.
I switched back and forth between, like, literary representations mm-hmm. and, like, journalistic pieces,
right.
which is another sort of jump that I made.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I struggled with. How do I justify that? Something that Richard has pushed me on, still pushes me on. How are you doing that? Jumping from this to this.
Jumping from, in the
literary,
same...
Literary, like, fiction, poetry, to, like, a journalistic article.
From, in the same time period, though.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, that,
no big deal.
It's done now.
Okay, good.
That's a good point, actually.
So, like that, and it's a voice. You know, they're all, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that.
I'm like, okay.
No,
I like
but
that.
I think
I'll
that
tell
you're.
Scott to come
yeah, but I think you're concerned about distinguishing memory, for instance, in reflections on the period from, you know, discussions at the time is a far more critical one than, you know, different genre expressions of commentary
right.
of the moment. I think that's.
Yeah, and
more
I think also when you're talking about what is a creative work doing something that's a little bit more specific
mm-hmm.
or different from what a non-creative work is doing?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, where does the idea of aesthetic come in? And
mm-hmm.
what role does that play?
Mm-hmm.
Like a creative aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I mean, I think there's ways in which you can complicate it and
mm-hmm.
say, oh, God, I don't know. And then, yeah, maybe there's ways when you can say, look, these are just different voices. These are it's commenting on a historical event. I mean, my answer is quite often that what better moment is it to transcend genre than
mm-hmm.
talking about
that's right.
historical event?
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
oh, yeah.
I'm not, you know, comparing apples and oranges.
Oh, no, not at all.
Why did you decide to focus on Atlanta? I think you said you started out with just riots in general.
Mm-hmm.
Why did you decide this one?
Mm.
I mean, I just keep coming back to it because it was so vicious. And because so many important people, I mean, Du Bois lived in Atlanta,
mm-hmm.
Henry U. Proctor, Jesse Max Farber, you know, it was also at a critical moment in terms of the history of black intellectual thought,
mm-hmm.
and and that's really where I'm going eventually is, you know, what is the sort of reciprocal relationship between black intellectual thought and racial violence?
Mm-hmm.
Right, and black intellectual thought, particularly, specifically on racial hierarchies mm-hmm. and racial ideologies. So here you have this critical moment. You know, you have to remember that when Washington gave his Atlanta Exposition speech, Du Bois sent him a letter congratulating him, you know, and then applied for a job at Tuskegee. Mm-hmm. So this is really the moment at which Du Bois is, and the cleavage between Du Bois and Washington mm-hmm. is widening, mm-hmm. and where they are really bumping heads in terms of this phase of Du Bois' mm-hmm. life. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's just really interesting to see how people are negotiating those things. Also, it's on the heels of the 1890s, which, you know, had the highest number of lynchings ever in any mm-hmm. decade. Mm-hmm. So it's at the height of racial violence. Mm-hmm. It happens in a southern city that's being heralded as the New South, the sort of pinnacle of post-slavery, post-Reconstruction renewal. And it also deals with issues of voting, which happens in the Wilmington riot as well. It centers around an election. So you have this political power and this political disfranchisement that ties into the violence. And what that means in terms of black masculinity and in terms of black male sexuality. And I mean, there's just so many fascinating things about it that I keep going back to it. But right now I'm reading up on the Springfield riot of 1908 because that's sort of where I next want to sort of go and see what happens. But I've been with the Atlanta riot now for some time and it's just held my attention. The Wilmington riot held my attention for a long time. And
what's the biggest, I'm a movie person. Rosewood, obviously, was made into a movie. And I'm trying to figure out, it was actually the biggest riot that I had heard about, probably because of the movie. There was whatever, but would you say that there are some, I mean, that this one is more, not important, but significant or?
The Rosewood riot is a different time. See, like, this is the progressive era, 1908. Okay. When you get into, like, World War I period, and you get into, like, the Red Summer of 1919, and really the Great Migration, which really gets going after 1915, mm-hmm. that changes everything, right? As blacks really leave the South, and what does that mean in terms of dynamics that have been going on before? So that was another reason why I shortened it, because you're really talking about different historical moments. And I found that I was working too hard to make these connections when it would be better and more fruitful for me to concentrate on a smaller time period and find out what were really the dynamics going on right now, at this mm-hmm. time, and then leave the rest for other people. But, I mean, I think in terms of that era, I'm really attracted to Chicago in 1919 mm-hmm. because...
The
26 race riots happened across the U.S. that summer. Yep. They call it the Red Summer.
Red Summer. 1919. The 19-teens, like 1915 was a really bad year too.
Which one?
1915, because that's when the redneck Thomas Woodrow Wilson was president. Oh my God, that's a
bad
year.
Praised Birth of a Nation.
Ooh. Yes. He had the screening in the White House for crying out loud. Boy, he was bad.
Yeah, well, you know, hey, I don't know if you guys noticed, but Roosevelt didn't send any troops to Atlanta. And he should have. And he was silent. And they asked for federal intervention, and he didn't.
Was there ever any effort to prosecute any white mobs?
Yeah, there were some indicted. I think maybe one or two charged.
One or two.
Huh? Well, not charged, convicted. But there were about 20, according to one of the newspaper articles, there were about 20 who were indicted. But yeah, there were. And also, you know, the reason why they let a lot of those Brownsville suspects go is because people wanted this to be over. And they wanted to, like, move on. So part of it was saving face. The whole thing was saving face. Yeah.
I'm interested about the notion of that Atlanta had already started to establish a reputation as the city of the New South.
Yeah.
When this occurred. And I always thought that was kind of a later phenomenon. And I'm wondering what this moment did. Did it accelerate because people wanted to get away from the shame? Did it accelerate the movement towards the New South?
Yeah.
Or
You know, during this period, according to the population estimates, the population was like doubling. I mean, it was really growing rapidly. I don't think it hurt that, Because like that 1919 picture that we looked at, it's very different than if you see it in 1906. I mean, it was still rapidly commercializing. And you know, I'm from Memphis. Isn't it really interesting to see how industrialized Atlanta was and Memphis still isn't like that? This is like 1908. So I don't think, I mean, momentarily it was hurt. And there were all of these newspaper articles afterwards that talked about the literal economic impact. The bank clearings were lower. There was less commerce that happened. There was a labor shortage because some blacks left. And so there was like an immediate impact. I don't think long term, because you have to remember the Klan gains power in the state of Georgia. And the next thing you know, you got a Klan member for governor, Klan members on the city council.
Lieutenant
The Klan becomes the establishment in Georgia and rules the state. And
how early?
Really, as early as like 1915, they start to really reorganize.
And Atlanta figures in that?
Atlanta figures in that. Mark Bauerlein talks about that a little bit at the end of his book, how that he kind of gestures towards the future, how the Klan will become. So let's end. So I think she can end the tape and then we can talk formally.